Okay, now we're going to talk about interstitial disease. So the interstitium is everything that's in between the tubules and the glomeruli. So this picture here represents normal kidney histology. And so you can see there's lots of tubules. They all look healthy. And so the interstitium is all this pink stuff in between. And so what lives here? Some interstitial cells and connective tissue. And so this is another compartment where disease can develop. As you can see here, I've added a picture that represents interstitial nephritis. So as we can see, there are many cells that are now in the interstitium. So these are inflammatory cells that have now moved to the interstitial space. They've pushed tubules aside. They've caused like a big inflammatory response, and it disrupts the normal architecture inside the kidney. And so this inflammation is taking place in between the other stuff, in between the tubules, in between the glomeruli. And it causes acute kidney injury. So let's go over a couple things that can cause interstitial nephritis. Okay, if I had to make a list of all the things that can cause interstitial nephritis, these are the main sort of buckets I would make. So for the infections that can cause interstitial nephritis, really a pyelonephritis is essentially, it's a bacterial infection that made its way all the way up to the kidney and has infected the kidney. And so pyelonephritis is a form of interstitial nephritis that causes acute kidney injury. Patients are typically pretty sick, and the cells that are infiltrating tubules and interstitium are PMNs, so they're neutrophils. Also, we see polyomavirus, so more specifically, the BK virus is something that causes BK nephropathy, which is a interstitial nephritis in kidney transplant patients. Also, we've seen adenoviral interstitial nephritis. Mycobacteria, TB has been reported, and many, many other bacteria and even fungus have been reported in case reports to cause interstitial nephritis. Now, the next category, a number of systemic and immune-related diseases. So, sarcoidosis is a relatively common cause for interstitial nephritis among patients with sarcoid. And then, patients with lupus, can have an interstitial nephritis. There is typically something also going on in the glomerulus, but there can be an interstitial nephritis there. TINU is a syndrome, tubular interstitial nephritis with uveitis, another autoimmune disease. It can be seen with Sjögren's syndrome. And then there's another disease called the IgG4 related disease, that's just a systemic illness, and it can cause an interstitial nephritis. And then of course, in our transplant patients, kidney transplant, that is, acute cellular rejection is essentially an interstitial nephritis where there's an immune response directed against the allograft. All right, next are certain medications that actually cause an allergic interstitial nephritis. So these are some drugs that have been shown to cause interstitial nephritis. So penicillins and cephalosporins are common reasons for this. For some reason, methicillin seems to be a drug that is known to cause interstitial nephritis with good frequency. Cipro can do this, NSAIDs can do this, rifampin, sulfonamides, including Bactrim, allopurinol is known to do this, and also PPIs. Apparently this is a class effect. So any of the PPIs, the proton pump inhibitors, have been shown to cause an interstitial nephritis. There are others that are on this list. I just didn't include here, but just if you suspect interstitial nephritis, make sure you look at the medication list and cross-check it against a good reference or resource that you enjoy using to see if it's ever been associated, because it could well be the reason for acute kidney injury. So once again, when you're working up your patient with acute kidney injury, you're doing a urinalysis and a urine microscopy. So if your patient has interstitial nephritis or interstitial damage, what would you see? Well, the pattern on urinalysis, I mean, think about it. There's lots of inflammation in the interstitium, and this translates to lots of white blood cells showing up in the urine. You may have a little bit of proteinuria, traced to a gram of albuminuria could be seen, and maybe this depends on what else is going on at the glomerular level, but it's not uncommon to see just like trace protein in the urine. And, maybe a few red blood cells, but not a lot, certainly not to the same degree as you see in nephritis. The pattern here is predominantly dominated by white blood cells or pyuria. In fact, the urine appears milky if there's enough inflammatory cells there. And so what would you see if you did urine microscopy? So you'd see many white blood cells. And so this is just kind of a crude drawing of what they look like, but they're large cells. They're well demarcated. So you can actually see the granules inside the white blood cells. So especially if there's many neutrophils, you can actually see them, and they're large in size. And so for comparison, they're larger than a red blood cell, which I've added sort of on the edge of the frame here. And I don't know if this helps or not, but I tell people that they sort of look like oatmeal raisin cookies based on their size and their general roundness. So look for that when you're looking at urine. And if you see many of them, that can be a sign that there's interstitial nephritis. So if you look closely, you may also see a white blood cell cast. So this would represent significant inflammation in the kidney and in the tubules. So if there are enough white blood cells or leukocytes in the tubules, they sort of stick together in a matrix material, and eventually it comes out in this cast that you can detect in the urine microscopy. So the rule for the red blood cell cast holds true for the white blood cell cast, that only disease all the way up to the tubules within the kidney could cause something like this. So if you see this, that's pretty specific for interstitial nephritis, whereas just seeing white blood cells or pyuria in the urine, could just be cystitis or urinary tract infection. But if you see a white blood cell cast, that's a sign of interstitial nephritis. Could be pyelonephritis, could be something else. But at least look for something like this. Could be an excellent clue.
Okay, let's quickly talk about urine eosinophils, because this was a test that was used more frequently to potentially make the diagnosis of interstitial nephritis, more specifically like a drug-induced interstitial nephritis. And so I do like this paper by Murethy and others that basically looked at all patients who had a kidney biopsy and had urine eosinophils measured. And so this was using a 1% cutoff of urine eosinophils using the Hansel stain. And so basically what they found is that for interstitial nephritis, this test had a nearly 31% sensitivity and a 68% specificity for that diagnosis. And the likelihood ratios are not very impressive at all. So it basically appears like this test didn't change the likelihood of having the disease or not having the disease. And essentially what the authors found is that there are a lot of different things that can cause eosinophiluria and have a positive test for urine eosinophils. So think of infections in the bladder, in the prostate. Pyelo can do it. Atheroembolic disease can do it. Surprisingly, ATN, so acute tubular necrosis, can do it, and a rapidly progressive GN can do it. So it's just not that specific. I'm not sure it's that helpful, and you probably get more bang for the buck from looking at the patient, examining for other clinical signs or symptoms, and then looking at the medication list for any medication that is known to cause AIN.
And that concludes this overview of intrinsic renal disease.